This is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope.
AWR Ghana. Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. Everybody said that anybody could do the important thing somebody should do. Everybody knows that anybody could do all the good things that nobody did.
Well, the preacher came to me and said what I ought to do if I wanted to make my religion true. He'd do it himself, but he really didn't have the time. He said that the duty wasn't mine. Oh, no.
Everybody said that anybody could do
not me.
The important thing somebody should do.
Not
everybody knows that anybody could do all the good things that property did.
Why me?
Everybody said that anybody could do.
No.
The important thing somebody should do.
You go.
Everybody knows that anybody could do all the good things that property did.
Well, the deacon came by and said, give me a hand. If you want me going to the promised land, here is something that I don't have time to do, so I better give it to you. Oh, no.
Everybody said that anybody could do the important thing somebody should do. Everybody knows that anybody could do all the good things that Bob did.
Not me.
Everybody said that anybody could do the important thing somebody should
do. Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
He is able. Through prayer, the impossibilities of man become the possibilities of God. Matthew 10:27. This was read from the book God's Little Book of Prayer by Richard Daly, and I am Andrew Boateng Bexon.
This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
Aimlessly beneath the barren sky, leave it to me, I lead you home. So afraid that you will not be found, it won't be long before your sun goes down. Just leave it to me, I lead you home.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Youth Corner. Today, we continue with our discussion on the Holy Spirit. My name is Afrenia Makeke. I'm here with Gabriel Edwe Champon and Lord Justice Kumi. Last time round, we looked at who the Holy Spirit is and how the Holy Spirit operates in our world today among Christians. We looked also at whether the Holy Spirit indeed did come to replace Jesus Christ in totality, or has a different function from what Jesus Christ did perform when he was here on earth. As I did indicate earlier, I'm here with Justice Kumi and Gabriel Edwe Champon. Welcome, gentlemen, to Youth Corner.
Thank you very much.
All right, just before we go to the Menishe, we wanted to make a point.
We're talking about the personality, Holy Spirit. Some people think that the Holy Spirit is just a working force of God. They don't see the Holy Spirit as a personality on his own. Mm. But when you read Luke chapter 12, verse 12, it's drawing our attention to the fact that for the Holy Ghost shall teach you what he ought to say. The teach here is an action word, and for somebody to teach is to somebody who is knowledgeable. For somebody to be knowledgeable, in this context, we're talking about a personality, somebody. The Holy Spirit is not just any force behind what God does, but it's a personality on its own. And the Holy Spirit was manifested during the baptism of Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit
in the form of a dove.
In the form of a dove appeared unto Jesus Christ, and the Father said, "This is my beloved Son." So here too, you see the agreement in the Trinity. The Father said, "This is my beloved Son." Christ also allowed himself to be baptized, and the Holy Spirit came to confirm the baptism. So it is actually a personality on its own.
Okay, I'll come to you a lot on this next question. Let me start off with you. Is there a difference between the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit?
Actually, there isn't a difference. They can be used in
this has confused a lot of Christians as well. Is there a difference, really?
You're talking about the same person, the same personality, Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, the same personality. But just that the ghost and the spirit, people also see to be the same or synonymous or whatever. That's what some people see to be. It's the same personality we're talking about. So there isn't any difference.
Lord, you think same?
Yeah.
That the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit mean the same thing?
Basically, they mean the same thing, but I think it's just because of modernism of language and time. I'm not actually privy to the reason why it was ghost and then the reason why these days we see Holy Spirit in the new Bibles. But I think maybe it's just because languages keep changing, and then because languages are dynamic, maybe the Holy Spirit appeared in some ghost-like structures in the olden days. That's why perhaps in the olden versions of the Bible, name it ghost. But currently, the new versions keep on hinting on the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. I think it's just because of perhaps dynamism in language or perhaps change of time. But actually, they mean the same thing, both the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit.
Okay, another issue that needs to be clarified here as well, that speaking in tongues demonstrate of the fact that one has received Holy Ghost baptism.
There are so many gifts you get as a result of being baptized by the Holy Spirit. The tongues is one, but it doesn't really mean if I'm not able to speak in tongues, I've not been baptized by the Holy Spirit. Actually, Peter and the other disciples had been immersed into water, but the power came on them when they met to meet, and then they spoke in different languages they themselves could not interpret. It was others who came for the festival of Pentecost who were outside who could really kind of interpret the languages they were speaking. It's a sign. Actually, that's not the only fruit of the Spirit. Some of the spirits, according to Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, if you recall, some of them are patience, love, you know, long-suffering, all those things. They are all part of the fruit of the Spirit. But these days, we are just kind of limiting it to speaking in tongues alone. But it's also a fruit of the Spirit. But you not speaking in tongues, that's not
Let's distinguish between something here. We have gifts of the Spirit and fruits of the Spirit. Don't we?
Yes,
they are two different things.
Yeah.
How different are these?
If somebody has wisdom, faith, somebody has patience, or maybe doing good, generosity, somebody is generous, somebody has some of these characters, like speaking in different languages or speaking in different tongues, they are all gifts of the Spirit. But when you get the gifts of the Holy Spirit, those gifts will help you to bear the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Yes. So that is one way to understand it.
Lord, you have a different opinion on that as well.
No, basically, they are the same. So what I was trying to say is, there are gifts and there are fruits. But, you know, gifts are not given to everybody. Gifts are selected. It depends on how, let me say, how close you are to me. I might choose to give you something at the expense of our brother Gabriel. I might also choose to give brother Gabriel something at the expense of you. It depends on how your proximity with me is. And so perhaps we as Christians can all get the power of tongues to speak in other languages, yet yours might come before brother Gabriel's. So it's actually out of the gift that we bear fruits. And so if people see, oh, you are patient enough, love your neighbor as yourself, then it means it's coming as a result of the gift God has given you. That's the Christ-like behavior we have to possess. So actually, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 to 14 talks about the speaking of tongues and speaking in other languages and all that. So they are parts of the gifts of the Spirit. They are gifts that we receive as a result of being baptized into the Holy Spirit.
Okay, so the gifts actually bear the fruits of the Spirit.
Exactly.
All right, what purpose do these gifts serve to the individual?
The gifts of the Spirit should edify the church, for the church to progress in growth, and members of the church to know Christ better than before. And to the individual, when we read 2 Corinthians 3:17, it says, now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So you are asking the importance of the Holy Spirit in the life of a Christian. When the Holy Spirit is with you, you have liberty, you are free. Why? Because any behavior that you put up, that you will not be safe in the judgment of God. The Holy Spirit will help you to do away with such behavior. So wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So if the Spirit is with us, we are free. We have power over the devil. We have power over sin. We have power over temptation. And when we have power over temptation, it means we have access to the crown of life. So to the Christian, if the Holy Spirit leaves you, that is where you obey the devil. And as a result of obeying the devil, you are not free, because on the judgment day, you are not going to be spared.
Thank you so much, Gabriel Dwe Champo and Lord Justice Kumi, for joining me on this part of the discussion on the Holy Spirit as well. My name is Afreni Amakeke. I've been your host for today's program. Join us for a continuation on this particular topic.
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box, AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again,
030-7051-058. For one so low as I, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Ooh, ooh, was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace. beyond degree.
Cherished listener, this is the moment of truth, where truth is presented with precision and exactness. Enjoy this encounter of a lifetime.
I would like to welcome you all back again to our series, Patience in the Midst of Trials and Affliction. I'm Dr. Samuel Corantin Pepim speaking for AWR. Our series is designed to answer questions we all ask when we go through trials and afflictions in our lives. We've discovered in our previous presentations that a day is coming when the unthinkable will happen in your life. Something you never expected could happen, it will happen. Such is the nature of life. As long as we live on this sinful world, we are all going to go through some trials and afflictions. But when they do occur, our natural reaction is why? And so during the past series of presentations, I've devoted some time studying with you why trials come our way. The basic premise is trials are a gift of grace, from our Heavenly Father to His children. And depending on how we deal with them, it will work out for our good and to His glory. In this segment and the next, I will be attempting to answer the question, how do we deal with trials so as to benefit from them? How do we deal with trials so as to benefit from them? I need to emphasize again that in the course of our lives, we will all experience trials and afflictions. The experience could be the death of a loved one. It can be disappointment with others or even with ourselves. It can be the discovery of some illness, the experience of a broken heart, a broken home, or a broken hope. It could even be the hurt or betrayal or even the suffering of an injustice. Depending on how we handle these experiences, the trials can either make us bitter or better. So the question is, what attitude should we adopt so as to benefit from our painful trials and afflictions? This is what we will attempt to answer in this segment and the next. First, I'll give you a couple of points to think about. Whenever trials come your way, number one, believe that God has a purpose in permitting the trials. Believe that God has a purpose in permitting the trials. In fact, that is what we've been attempting to answer in the previous presentations with the question, why? But let me sharpen it a little more. When you read Lamentations chapter 3 and verse 33, Lamentations are a series of cries that the prophet Jeremiah, you know, presented, knowing very well that his people are going to go through some painful experiences. Lamentations chapter 3 verse 33, he says, God does not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men. When God permits trials, He doesn't do so willingly for no reason. You know, there is always a reason why He permits the trials our way. In fact, Hebrews 12 verse 10 says, when God permits trials and afflictions or discipline or anything our way, it is for our profit that we might be partakers of His holiness. And of course, Psalm 34:19 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from out of them all. My point is simply this. There is a purpose behind every trial that comes our way. We may not fully understand it, but one day it will be made clear. I read the account some time ago about a gardener and his fruitless tree. The account reads that one evening, a gentleman was walking very depressed because of a deep affliction. This gentleman, as he was walking through the garden, he observed a particular tree which had nearly been cut through the stem. Wondering, he asked the gardener why that tree was in this condition, and then he received an answer that explained to his satisfaction the wounds of his own bleeding heart. The gardener said to this gentleman who was going through difficulty, he said, this tree used to shoot out so strong that it bore nothing but leaves. I was obliged to cut it this manner, and when it was almost cut through, it began to bear fruit. What's the point? There is a reason behind every trial God permits our way. We may not fully understand it, but there is a reason. And so when we go through trials, in order to bear it, tell yourself, my God does not afflict willingly. He doesn't grieve us mindlessly. There is a reason. That leads to reason number two. Believe also that all things will work out for our good. He has a purpose, and that purpose will allow the trials and afflictions to work for our good. I'm sure you are familiar with that powerful Bible text, Romans 8:28, which says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them who are called according to his purpose. Notice he says all things work together for good. Not some things work together for good. Not even most things work together for good. The text says all things work together for good. Whether good or bad, ill or not, all things work together for good. In fact, when you read verses 35, 38, and 39, we discover that all things include tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, sword, death, principalities, powers. I mean, all things work together for good to them that love the Lord Jesus Christ. Beethoven composed much of his music while he was deaf. Milton composed poetry while he was blind. Jackie Joyner Kersee won Olympic gold medal after overcoming polio. Florence Nightingale reorganized the hospitals of England while he was too ill to move from her bed. The Apostle Paul also tells us he was able to accomplish much despite the thorn in his own flesh. He built churches, traveled more distances, wrote more books despite his many afflictions. The point is this: there is a purpose in every trial. And second, all things will work together for good to them that love the Lord. Joseph also illustrates this point. You recall how the hatred, the jealousy and envy of his brothers led them to put him in a pit. Later on, sold him as a slave. And in slavery, someone lied about him. It says Potiphar accused him of attempted rape, have him thrown in jail. He was forgotten by one of his friends in jail. But later on, looking back on all the experiences, the wasted years and the hurt, he said to his friends, his brothers, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. You meant evil against me, God meant it for good. Genesis 50, verse 20. All things work together for good to them that love the Lord. There is a reason. How do you bear then the trials? Believe there is a reason. And number two, that reason, that ultimate purpose God has, will work for your good and to God's glory. We continue our series in our next segment. I am Dr. Samuel Corantin Pepim for AWR in our series, Patience in the Midst of Trials and Afflictions.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box, AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo Ansendu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you. We'll be right back.